October, Joe's older than dirt. We've never done an event for 4 years other than there, but we have a special opportunity and I couldn't pass up on it. So we're excited to be here. Let's start with Lee. You want to come up and talk to us a little bit? Are you ready?
Yeah.
Lee, come on up and tell us who you are, why we're here, and what can they can expect in the future.
I love that. Thank you. The Global Field Labs Foundation. This is a labor of love for us. They have worked on this project for about 2 years, and we're so happy and so proud to welcome you into this space. You are the first group that has been in the actual Amber Room, which is what we're calling our space.
I didn't hear you. Were the what?
This is the, you are the very first group.
Thank you. Cool place, huh? Hey, where's Bill Whalen? Hey, Bill, stand up. So, I think Lewis is going to share a little bit more, but Bill's an old friend. Bill coincidentally owns this property. He redid it all for The Last Refuge. It's incredible. Thank you. You told me a year and a half ago what was going to happen. I saw the vision, but I didn't see this. Incredible. Thank you. And I'm going to bring up Lewis later, but Independence Bank is a sponsor for tonight. Independence Bank from Kentucky, I serve on the board for. We have other board members here. We have customers here, but Lewis is a great friend. In fact, he was on my driveway last night at 3 in the morning. That's why I'm not doing well today. Well, maybe it was 2, but we're glad you're here, and he'll get to come up and talk to you a little bit. So thank you for being here. So Big Bourbon Club, how many people here are not members of my club, the Big Bourbon Club? Raise your hand high. Well, hold on, we're going to stop this damn show. So, bourbon is good. Big Bourbon Club. We have 6,000 members globally, 50 states, 14 countries, and we have a free. Hello, Michael. I haven't seen you forever. We have a free membership, and the purpose, the mission of the club is to help people learn about bourbon, get behind that red velvet rope, and meet the people, meet the culture, taste the bourbon itself, and see things maybe before the public gets to see it. Not always, but today that's certainly the case. So there is a QR code on every table. Scan it. It's free. Everybody here can afford that. Free. Download the app, and on the app, the Big Bourbon Club app, we get every day 800 engagements a day from the Bourbon Club that we've created, and from friends and people that look very different from all walks of life, and the focus of the club is really more on bourbon beginners up to intermediates. It's not a bunch of experts and pros, though some of you are, and that's okay. This is about bringing bourbon to the world and helping grow the love for bourbon. So I would appreciate it if you would join and get involved. We do these monthly events. typically a Joe's Older Than Dirt. This is the first one we've done outside of Joe's. But we have a lot of fun. Next month, we have Old Forester. We have Blue Run in August. We have Michter's in October. And we have Grand Arum. I just left Panama not long ago. I did a barrel pick in Panama, the country, not the state, of Florida, where they, great rum, finished in bourbon barrels. And we'll release that at that pick. So we'd love to have you out there. So thanks for being here. Excited as hell about Heaven's Door. So my cousin Matt Wheatley was the head distiller at Heaven's Door until about 2 weeks ago. And that's how this was initially created. But we did a, what I call, Behind the Red Velvet Rope event on campus in Pleasureville, Kentucky, which is Henry County. It's a full hour and 20 minutes from here. I will tell you this. I've been there several times now. We had a group of Big Bourbon Club members there. It is the coolest campus of any distillery in Kentucky. It's brand new, and it's the coolest. It's not the second. It is the coolest. I'm not going to get into the campus, but you'll have to go see it and see what they've done there. It will blow your mind. And so these folks at Heaven's Door have been sourcing like everybody does until the brand takes off, until they start making their own bourbon and aging it. But they've been blending some really good stuff we're going to try tonight. So excited about Heaven's Door. And before we kick it off, let's do this. Lewis, are you ready? Okay, so let me bring up Lewis Straub, the president of Independence Bank, to welcome everybody. And so come on up.
Thank you all, everybody, for being here. Big Bourbon Club.
Okay.
So important to all of us in Kentucky. So, quick message about Independence Bank. We are the fourth largest bank domiciled in Kentucky. We're the largest privately held bank in Kentucky. Assets of $3.8 billion.
Thank you for clarifying that. Why the hell didn't you leave at 1 o'clock in the morning last night?
Because I was tired.
I'm exhausted.
It was a pleasure meeting some of y'all last night online. So, but the important thing about the bank is it's owned by its employees. So when you come in to see us, you're talking to the owners. You're talking to the owners. We have tellers. And we have service. We have no 800 numbers. So if you want service and you want to be taken care of, we're banking the way it used to be. We can do anything you need, commercial loans, personal loans, trust and investment. We're the fourth largest trust company in Kentucky. Now, enough of that. Okay. So the Big Bourbon Club is really I'm really happy to be here with the Big Bourbon Club. And I'm really happy to have Bill Whalen here with us. So Bill Whalen and his family, Mariah Gratz, Lee Whalen, Kent Whalen, and all of their spouses are here. So the Whalen family is why you're in this space. Whalen Ventures was responsible for getting this church and having the vision to turn it into something like this. And then hooking up with Bob Dylan and Heaven's Door, this is going to be a world-class space. It's putting Louisville on the map. And Steve is right. The distillery out in Henry County, it is a world-class distillery. There's nothing else like it. There's an old mill on the property. The distillery sits up on a hill. You go down a hill to a glade that's just absolutely beautiful. It's going to be an iconic space in Kentucky like several of our other distilleries. So I encourage you to go out and see this distillery once it's really up and running. It's fabulous. Now, one other thing about the Whalen family, Mariah Gratz, CEO and president of Whalen Ventures, it's her birthday today. Are you going to sing happy birthday to Mariah?
Big dog, you paid a lot of money for this. You can think you want.
All right, happy birthday, Mariah. Ready?
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Mariah. Happy birthday to you.
The truth is, we were on the driveway last night until 2 in the morning as he practiced that speech and the happy birthday song 32 times. Trivia question. Who wrote Happy Birthday and where are they from? Louisville, Kentucky. How about that? I should have been head of the chamber at one point in my life. All right. Okay. Let's get on. Who wants to drink some bourbon? Raise your hand if you've ever had Heaven's Door. Any expression? Okay, so maybe I'm going to say it's 20%. Raise your hand if you've never tried it. Raise your hand if you don't know that Bob Dylan created the brand. Okay, so Bob Dylan created the brand, and most of you know that, but you haven't had it, so we're going to have some fun. Adam Edwards, National Brand Ambassador. Adam, come on out. My old friend, Adam. Adam is going to take us through this tasting. He's an old pro and an old friend, all right?
Thank you very much, Steve.
Take it over, big guy.
How you doing, everybody? Good to see you. I see lots of familiar faces in this crowd. I've been around quite a bit. If any of you all have messed with me in any of my previous incantations, so I've been with a few distilleries here and there. My most recent was at Rabbit Hole. I was at Rabbit Hole for 5 years. I was their whiskey specialist, which essentially was their national brand ambassador. And then I got a very interesting offer through LinkedIn, of all places, which I usually don't even check my LinkedIn messages because most of the time it's spam. And I got this message kind of reaching out, and it was from Heaven's Door, and I knew about Heaven's Door, and I said, "Nah, I'm okay, thanks. I don't work for celebrity brands. Do you know who I am?" I know who I am. So, I kept saying no, and they were very insistent, and they took me out to dinner one night at, where did we go? I think we went to Repeal, and I got to taste all the expressions they had out at that point. And I was very impressed. And they kind of told me their story, which I'll tell to you in a minute. And then they showed me my budget. And I was like, yeah, let's do it. All right. Now we're talking. Now we're talking the real stuff, right? So I actually started with Heaven's Door last year, a little bit over a year ago. I was just Louisville at that point. Hey, what? I haven't seen you for a minute. How you doing? So, I really just focused on Louisville for a year. And at the beginning of this year, they said, let's move it on up. So I became their national brand ambassador and field marketing manager. So I do a lot of this, which is what I've kind of done my entire career now. Heaven's Door, as Steve very, very much said, is a sort of a product of Bob Dylan. So Bob actually had started an LTO for something called Bootleg Whiskey. Mark Bushala, whose company SIP had previously owned Angel's Envy, had just sold Angel's Envy to Bacardi. It's not a bad move. And he was looking to kind of continue his career in whiskey. And so he saw that LTO, and he was going to reach out to Bob's team when Bob reached out to him. And they set something up, and Mark was, very, very honest with them and said, listen, if you want to just do a one-off celebrity brand, sure. Make a couple million dollars, move on in the sunset. All right, fine. But does Bob Dylan really need more money? He's doing fine. And he was like, I know the people that can build a brand, and let's build something together. And their very first thing they did was decide to build a distillery on Broadway in Nashville. Now listen, I have heard a lot of bad ideas in my life, and I've worked for urban distilleries. As I said, I worked for Rabbit Hole right over here. And the logistics of bringing grain trucks in to downtown Louisville is really tough. It's hard. You make a lot of people mad during traffic hour on Jefferson Street when you hold that street up. And so they decided after a little bit that wasn't the move. And there was this beautiful distillery in Henry County in Pleasureville, hilariously Amish
Pleasureville.
Country.
Pleasureville. Think about that.
Amish country, too. Love that.
Booth. There was no marketing behind that.
It was
already Pleasureville.
They 100% do know how to party. Okay. They 100% the opposite know how to party. So that went up for sale. And it was, kind of like middle of the year after the pandemic. I've been through a couple of distillery acquisitions. I've never seen liquid change hands as part of a deal. Usually it's just material. Usually liquid gets sold off separately. We, all of a sudden, were sitting on several thousand barrels of aged up Kentucky bourbon. It was a perfect move. So that one that you have in front of you right now, that's what this is. This is Ascension. This is our Kentucky bourbon, Kentucky straight bourbon. Now, the amount that we had, we knew that was not going to last us the next 4 to 5 years that we were going to need to age up more product. And we've been distilling there now since middle of 2020, end of 2020. So we knew we were going to need a little bit more time, right? So we actually asked a really great partner, Green River Distilling. Green River's great, right? And they were very gracious to sell us some of their product so we could blend this together with more Kentucky bourbon and stretch it out. When I first started, that blend was about 60-40. So 60% ours, about 40% theirs. It's been moving so quickly that it has dropped down. We're using almost less than 30% of their product in that bottle now. So it's very quickly moving into the stuff that we have made, that we're aging, and we're always looking to keep that plus five. So that's what this is. So cheers. Let's have a drink together, right? Cheers. Yeah. Now, this is 92 proof. Mash bills on this. So the Green River mash bill, I believe, is 72 corn. Our mash bill down at in Pleasureville is right at 76 corn. So they're pretty close. And then rye is the secondary grain. There's not a wheated grain in this. And then the rest malted barley. If you've got a little water in front of you and you want to, like, you know, just, I don't know, dip your finger in there and drop a couple drops in there, I think it gets super floral. I think you get a lot of tobacco on this right up front, and that tobacco with a little water actually gets pretty floral. It really gets pretty floral. Does everybody have water? Anybody missing water? Yeah. Need a couple more waters. A couple more waters. Got waters over here. Waters over here. X, thank you very much. It's pretty informal, so when you run out of something, just shout it out, right? So what do you think of this? How's this going? It's not bad, right? Right now, our stuff that's in this is generally right about 5.5 years, almost getting close to 6. But the stuff from Green River was right at 5, so we call this a 5-year-old bourbon. That's the youngest that's in there. Yeah. Proof, 92 proof. This is right at 92 proof, yeah. So a little bit more about that distillery. I know, you know, Steve, how many people, I know some of you all went down there. How many people here have been down to 6 Mile? Yeah? Excellent, excellent. So a lot of you haven't. That's great. So it's about an hour from here. The name of the distillery was 6 Mile Creek. And the guy that had owned that distillery before, really, really, really good guy, he just could not make it through the pandemic. A lot of places could not make it through that, right? So he was looking for a buyer. So we very quickly snapped that up. It made sense. We moved our whole operation into Kentucky. You know, I think, which we'll get to that next, we'll do a little Tennessee bourbon here in a minute. But it was, I think, important to Mark and to Bob to make sure that we had a very nice Kentucky mark. And this hits that mark for me.
Damien Prather, oh, yeah, Damien, 1981, yep.
Yeah.
That started it and didn't finish it.
Yeah, it's, you know, and he had a lot of neat stuff going down there. It's 160-plus acres. Squire Boone, anybody know who Squire Boone is, brother of Daniel Boone?
Daniel
he spent
Boone.
A lot of time there. He said that was the most perfect piece of property in the entire world. It has 6 Mile Creek running through it. Damien actually did a very cool thing down at 6 Mile. He got all of these cabins from the late 18th century up into the mid 19th century, disassembled in places like Ohio, Pennsylvania, disassembled, put on trucks, brought down to Kentucky, and reassembled using period tools down on that property. So there's something like five or six.
There's a grist mill down
there's
there
a running grist
that was
mill.
1800.
Yeah. That's actually the next thing we're going to go down there. We're going to mill some corn together. So that's going to be great.
I will say this. It's the coolest distillery campus in Kentucky.
It is very neat.
It's not the oldest, not the biggest. It's the coolest because of what he did with that. Yeah.
It's a beautiful spot. We are looking for an end of summer opening. So visitor center is almost done. It's really, really close. We've got an 18-inch still in that that distillery. That still gets us anywhere between like 6,500 to 8,000 barrels a year, which when you're really trying to build a huge brand, that's not going to cut it. So we've actually got a 36-inch still that's going to be dropped into, I know, it's huge, into another distillery. It's on the property, so we're actually building like a separate distilling house that we're going to drop that still in, and that 18-inch still is going to become our R&D. Still, and this is the way I think about it. This is going to be a dumb question. How many here have been to Buffalo Trace? Everyone raise your hands. There you go. So Buffalo Trace, if you've ever done their hard hat tour, they will actually take you to see their experimental still, which is really small. that's kind of what we're thinking about with R18 and still. It's going to be R&D and kind of smaller runs of things to kind of start getting that stuff distilled. So we can do kind of one-offs and really experimental things. That 36-inch still is going to be the workhorse, and that is going to get us anywhere between 59 to 61,000 barrels a year. So you can see the amount of capital that we are putting in to the state of Kentucky for this. I am a Kentucky boy, so I'm very happy with that. And I like the Kentucky bourbon. I think it's very good. The name Ascension really comes from that idea of Kentucky bourbon is where you ascend to when it comes to American whiskey, right? That is considered, I'm just not just saying this because I'm from Kentucky, it is perfect place to make bourbon, right? We've got our next one. Lee, are you behind me somewhere? No, I'm all alone. Look at that. We're going to go ahead and get the next one out to you here in a second. We'll start talking about that. But, Steve, do you have questions for me about this one?
Well, no, but I do want to ask the crowd. So this is Ascension.
This is Ascension. This is Ascension.
So tell us what you got. What did you get on Ascension? Yeah, what's the nose, the palate? Did you like it? Have you ever had? So raise your hand. Have you ever had Ascension before? Because it's been out for a bit.
Yeah, it's, September is when we launched this product.
So most people haven't had it. What do you think? Shout it out.
100%, yeah.
So just for the record, in 48 months, the Callahans haven't disliked anything. So I love the Callahans. They're
Irish.
It's
a good focus group over here. I like it. Yeah, they, no, stone fruit, 100%. Somebody said apricot.
Isn't it
tons
good?
Tons of stone fruit on this. The water does change. So tell me, what do you think it took it to? Where do you think it changed? Honey? Honeysuckle.
Honey, yeah, I get honey.
Some of that wildfire. A lot of honey. Mm-hmm. Yep, lots of wildflower in there, absolutely.
What did you say the proof is?
So proof is 92. I think without water, you get this really cool kind of tobacco note. And you got to follow me on this one. The nose of Ascension to me, and especially the distillate, not like unaged Ascension. When I nose unaged Ascension, it smells like I've taken a cigarette and, like, snapped it in half and smelled that tobacco. Like, that is what, I know, crazy, right? Like, that is what it really smells like to me is the distillate. And I think the oak kind of deepens that a little bit, and it gets a little bit more kind of aromatic tobacco, right? When you look at a flavor wheel, so in distilleries, and we use a lot of QC, obviously. We're quality controlling a lot, and we have those flavor wheels in front of us. And on the flavor wheel, tobacco and floral kind of live in that same part of that flavor wheel. So when you're adding water, you're breaking apart a lot of those oils. You're kind of maybe opening up a few congeners that you didn't get without that water. And so when you do that to this, I think that tobacco kind of pulls back a little bit and you really just get the floral aspects of it. What else are you getting on this? Somebody else shout out something. I want to hear, but it's like a focus group for me.
You all getting any spiciness on it?
Caramel. Lots of caramel. Yeah, lots of caramel.
Almond.
Almond. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. A little nuttiness to it. Nutty flavors kind of live pretty close to those floral and aromatic flavors,
they
too.
They say the nutty
meal.
Flavors relate to the person drinking it a lot of times.
Well.
Who said it? I'm just being
facetious. Everything you drink is pretty nutty? Is that what you're saying?
I'm being facetious, which that's a big word for you, Adam. But.
It is. It was on my calendar this morning, though, so I looked it up. So I think what we're going to do now, we're going to go ahead and see if we can get this second one out to you. So we'll take a little, just you know, keep on trying this, and we're going to go ahead and start getting that worked out.
Hold on a second. Yeah. They couldn't answer when we ask them, but when we're talking, they're interrupting.
Oh, yeah. What do you got? Yeah.
Mark and Jeremy. By the way, they've got the biggest podcast on planet Earth about bourbon, just FYI. But go ahead, Jeremy.
Oh, the names. So like Ascension, Revival, all that. So originally, and this is why I kind of love having this banner right here. These were our old labels, and they were not skewed out that way. They didn't have that name, right? It was just your straight bourbon whiskey, your double barrel, and then the rye. The names happened right when we came out. We were going to have this Kentucky bourbon because we were like, we don't want to put two bourbons out there, one from Tennessee, one from Kentucky, with nothing on the label other than that one word that's going to differentiate them, right? So we really, first of all, we went to Bob because, let's face it, Bob Dylan. A wordsmith, right? He's a lyricist. You ask that guy for some names, he's going to give you a book. So he really came at us with some very abstract ideas. We took those ideas and, for lack of a better word, distilled them down into core concepts. And ascension, there's a lot of kind of biblical references in the name. I mean, obviously with heaven's
door.
Raise
your hand if there's any Christians in the house. I mean, we're not taking a count or anything. I'm just curious.
What a loaded question, man. Yeah. You, how many of y'all been to church?
Ben just put up both arms.
When's the last time
okay.
y'all been to church?
We don't care if you're not.
We are in. That's the thing.
Let's talk
this
about
is
Republicans
the high church
and Democrats.
Urban, right?
We're not going politics. Sorry.
So, yeah, ascension was really where that came from. It was like, all right, we're moving a large part of our brand into Kentucky. And to be completely honest with you, is going to become the focus of this brand, right? Is Kentucky. Of course it should be. And so what is the greatest whiskey on the planet? For me, it's Kentucky bourbon.
For me, it's the one in my hand.
Yeah, there you go. And so we really kind of ascended into that. We took that product and said, this is the ascension. This is the pinnacle of American whiskey. Now, that does not mean that Tennessee whiskey or Tennessee bourbon is subpar to us. It really doesn't. And I'm comfortable enough in my Kentucky boy kind of persona to say there's some great Tennessee whiskey out there. But the ascension, the pinnacle of American whiskey is 100%
Adam,
Kentucky
where'd
bourbon.
You go to high school?
I went to South Oldham High School.
Oh,
so
shit. You could,
out there in Oldham
hold,
County?
Hold on. You couldn't get into North Oldham?
No, there was no North Oldham.
Oh, I thought it was a test score issue.
There was no.
I'm just joking. Just
North
joking.
Oldham. So I grew up in Prospect. That's where I grew up. But North Oldham was very
the
close.
The rich side of Louisville, if you're
you
not
know what?
Man. Everybody in Prospect is rich.
We moved out there 1987 when we moved out there. And we moved out there, there's like farmland everywhere, right?
When Adam stands on his wall, he's 18 feet tall.
Let me put it this way. My senior year of high school, my parking spot is South Oldham. I had a Mercedes next to me, and I had a Probe, a really nice Probe, right?
Without a doubt.
90s.
And you had an electric car before they came out.
I had a 1991 Mercury Tracer that the glove box was loaded tote. You could just pull it out of there and take it with you. When I turned left into my parking spot, the horn would slightly sound. So I was surrounded by a lot of money, but we were not there. We were not there.
I'm just having fun with you, Adam.
But it's amazing how much Prospect has grown up now. I go out there. It's incredible. Went to school at University of Kentucky. Go Cats. Go Cats. Went to University of Kentucky. Got my music degree.
Did you?
So,
So Adam plays the tuba.
I do play the
at
tuba.
At a high level. In fact, his handle is Bourbon Tuba.
Yeah, my handle is Bourbon Tuba.
Dude, were you in the Kentucky Marching Band?
I was in the Kentucky Marching Band. Of course I was the Kentucky Marching Band, because that's the only way that you could go play in the basketball games. Like, you go do the basketball pep band, you had to do the football.
You were the guy that got free tickets to go play the tube in the end zone.
Yeah, pretty much. Back then, and I say this with all the love of my heart, not a lot of people wanted Kentucky football tickets. Early 2000s, it was hard sell. It was hard sell. We went to like one bowl game the entire time out there, so it was like, well, we got to go do this.
I was in UK my entire. They sucked.
Yeah, it was hard.
No, we didn't go to games.
Let me put it this way.
We came to watch you play tuba.
I was there for the LSU game.
The Bluegrass Miracle.
Yeah.
I saw you on the goalpost when you thought we had won.
A lot of my friends were storming that field without having any idea what was happening on the scoreboard. Yeah. Oh, no. Well, never mind. It was a beautiful program. It was really good. But, yeah, so, I spent time in the UK and then moved back to Louisville, and this is what I settled into, music and bourbon, two things that go great together.
Hey, raise your hand if you're a UK graduate. I'm just curious. All right, there's about 92% of you UK graduate. Good.
Wait a minute.
Okay,
how many
there
of
was
you
not,
all are at University of Louisville?
I was going to ask, how many are Louisville graduates? Probably the same.
EKU, there you go. Yeah, you got EKU, and maybe you got some Hilltoppers in here.
You couldn't get to Western Kentucky?
It's Center, yeah, I get some Center graduates here. So.
All right, so raise your hand if you don't have the next expression yet. So we got a few left.
Just a few. Excellent.
All right, Adam, let's keep killing time with
you
bullshit.
Got it, yeah.
Sarah, you want to come up and speak? Come on. No, for real, for real. Come on. So everybody welcome Sarah Hines, a great big Bourbon Club member. She has no idea I was pulling her out of the crowd, but go ahead and get up there and say something. Make it meaningful, too.
Seriously?
Don't screw this up. You're in the camera. Go. In all seriousness, Sarah's an old friend, and she's a top shelf member of the club, and she has some girlfriends in. And about 2 weeks ago, I said, cancel the Michter's tour and bring him to this event. All right, now tease you up. Don't screw it up.
Since college, and that's all I know.
Hey, go sit down. It's okay.
That's
what I was gonna say. Sarah, we love you. Thanks for bringing your friends.
All right, it looks like we're getting our next sample out pretty quickly.
Any other thoughts on the first expression? Ascension. Maria, smooth.
Oh, price point. That's a great question. I should have said that. Yeah.
Hold on. Excuse me. My wife's first boss, Maria Gerwing. It's easy.
Absolutely.
It's a very easy, smooth taste, right?
That's what we wanted. We wanted that kind of very easy delivery.
So question, for real, when you sip bourbon neat, how many of you hold it in your mouth for 20 seconds or more, chew it a little bit, and swallow it very slowly? How many people chew your bourbon? Raise your hand. If you drink bourbon neat, put it in your mouth, let it acclimate, use your tongue to hit all the gums and all the parts of your mouth. It's getting 92%, 94%.
92, yeah.
And swallow slowly. And whether you like the bourbon or not, it's a different question, but you will get every bit of the tastiness, the flavor, when you do it.
Yeah.
So chew your bourbon from this point out on the last three.
You got to prime the palate, right? And I had somebody ask about the price point on this. This is generally, you find this in anywhere between 49 and like 54 is where we say that's our MSRP. But of course, you know, that kind of changes due to retailers and states. I think that first priming your palate's very important, right?
It is.
Yeah, I skipped over all that because I feel like this is the big bourbon club. You all are already pros, right? You know how to drink bourbon.
Well, now remember the mission of the Big Bourbon Club is to help people get involved in bourbon. So we got a lot of folks that haven't drank a lot of it. So.
All right, everybody got that second one already? We good? Got a few people? Yep. Excellent, excellent. So we're going to take you back to our early roots with this one. This is Revival. Revival. So another great name, right? I wonder how many people are going to call me out on this. I don't know. This is not Tennessee whiskey. Can anybody take a guess why this is Tennessee bourbon and it's not Tennessee whiskey? Anybody know?
No Lincoln County.
Exactly. No Lincoln County process.
Hold on, Ben Gillette. We've got one of those guys in the crowd that knows everything, and that's Ben Gillette. By the way, he's a direct descendant of the Gillette Razor Company. And when he stands on his wall, he's like 38 feet tall.
Yeah, so this did not go through the Lincoln County process, right? So this is not get, and if you're unfamiliar with the Lincoln County process, all that is you're taking the distillate right before you put it in the barrel. It's already been proofed down, barrel entry proof, and you run it through just, it's sugar maple charcoal, right? That's all you have to run it through. And in Tennessee whiskey, that is all about smoothing it out. I see people on both sides of this argument, right? Is it so subtractive that it removes some complexity of the whiskey? Sure. But it does also pull out some of those, what I like to call high esters. The esters that kind of hit you up here by the eyes, really tart citrus, lots of lemon, lots of grapefruit, and even a little bit into orange, right? It removes a lot of that. So Tennessee whiskey that has gone through that Lincoln County process tends to have a little bit more of a softer, kind of approachable to someone who doesn't drink a lot of whiskey sort of taste, right? So why didn't we want to do that? Well, again, this Revival was our first product that hit the market when we, I think it was 2018 is when that hit, right? So we wanted something that lived in bourbon, was a little bit more complex. And I think Revival does that. And when we were talking about making this product, there was this thing going on in Tennessee about lobbying for that designation that makes Tennessee whiskey. And we kind of saw the track on that, right? Mm-hmm. We saw that was going to become the main focus of most Tennessee suppliers, is making Tennessee whiskey and following through that Lincoln County process, which is great. It makes fantastic product. But we wanted to make bourbon. We wanted to make bourbon. Now, we don't have a distillery in Tennessee, right? The very first aspect of Revival was sourced, and it was straight up Dickel. And the reason it was Dickel is because one of our founders, Ryan, had a great relationship with them. And Dickel had entered the Tennessee bourbon market. And it, how do I say this kind of nicely? It was not doing great for them. It wasn't. It just was not getting picked up. Because I think they really, full disclosure, I am a Dickel fan. I like the Flintstone vitamins kind of talk. I like it. I'm a fan of the Dickel. So they were very happy to get rid of a lot of those bourbon stock that wasn't doing well for them. So we happily took it off their hands. We blew through that in like a year. I mean, it did not take us long at all. So now we're like, do we want to continue to source? Not really. Cheers, by the way. Go ahead and take a drink of that if you haven't. Cheers. Proof 92. So here's a great thing, and this is why I love doing these both side by side. Revival and Ascension, two, all the specs, not mash bill, right? Two specs, very similar. Same proof, same barrel entries, same, really distilling is not too far off between our two places, right? This came out of TDG, Tennessee Distilling Group. This was contracted. And if you are familiar with Tennessee Distilling Group, if you go to their website, there's no pictures of the distillery. There's like a picture of the road that leads their distillery, and you can like blow it up and get a pixelated look at their building. And they have like a contact us now button. That's it. They don't really allow a lot of people in there. But what's great about their system is that down to the type of yeast you want to use, your barrel entry, I mean, it's true contract distilling where we are literally, I always love this phrase, using somebody else's kitchen to cook, right? We're using their materials. It's really our stuff. And I love that look at it. Putting these side by side really kind of shows you the difference in things like microclimate. Now, mash bill on this is pretty high corn. I think it's 80 corn, 18 rye, and the rest to barley. So really high corn, right? So what does that leave? Like,
Adam, do you 4% malt to barley? Would you call 18% rye a high rye?
No. And I'm not really, I have trouble with that term high rye because it's unregulated. And high rye is really up to the distillery, right? Some distillery will have their high rye and their rye content is like 35%. And like, yeah, that's pretty high rye. But shit, some distilleries are going to, I mean, what's a good example? Bullet. Isn't Bullet like 49% rye or something like that? I mean, is that right? Or no, is it the other way? Is it their rye? Yeah. 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 So, I mean, like, you know, once you start getting into like your secondary grain being really high, I mean, I guess you can go ahead and call it a high rye or a high wheat or something like that. But I don't know. I mean, 18% to me in context with other distilleries, I don't really feel like that's a high rye bourbon. I think that's like kind of like a general rye bourbon. That's, you know, in between like that 15 right. to like 30% or 25%. That's pretty general or pretty standard for a rye secondary grain. So now that you've had Ascension and you've been drinking Revival, how shocked are you at the difference between the two? Right? I think that's a very neat concept to really explore. And I'll kind of give you a little bit of a peek behind the curtain. Kentucky and Tennessee, geographically, pretty close. You look at a map, they're pretty close, right? But the microclimate, especially where our warehouses are, which are in Memphis, pretty different than central Kentucky, right? It's a little bit hotter there. Mash bill is a little bit different. Yeast comes from the same place, by the way. We use the same yeast for both bourbons. Barrel entry proof, nominal difference. I think it's a difference of 125 down in Tennessee and enter in the barrel here in Kentucky at 120. So little differences, but really big difference in terms of flavor. Part of that you can attribute to that mash bill, high corn mash bill, right? But for me, I think the warehouse is really where you're seeing the difference in that. Warehouse differences, by the way, in Tennessee, all of it is palletized. In Kentucky, we've got a mix between palletized and ripped. So that could be the difference too. I feel like you actually get a lot of those very, very specific Tennessee high esters again, things that live up here. Lots of citrus. What do you all think? Tell me what you think. What are you all tasting in here? Yes, yes.
So, since we're in the middle, can you tell us the origin of the name?
Ah, Heaven's Door. The origin of the name Heaven's Door. Absolutely. It's from a Bob Dylan song. Yeah. So, I'm just being cheeky. So, originally, the brand was going to be called Bootleg. And if you know anything about Bob Dylan, man, that's like the Bob Dylan brand. You can see actually some of the bootlegs back here in those painted bottles. That's all Bob's art. And each one of those bottles always has his art on there. If you don't know, Bob Dylan is an amazing artist. He also has, he makes these big black iron gates. It's called Black Buffalo Ironworks. And they are art pieces. They're amazing. But he was really, you know, thinking, oh, I'm just going to kind of do this one off because guy doesn't have time to run a bourbon brand, right? And then do this one off, we'll call it Bootleg, right? And when Mark came in and was talking to him, let's actually make this a bigger brand. Let's make this a little bit more consistent. Have your core products, have your LTO, right? We need to have something that ties together not just your lyrics, but the idea of what Kentucky bourbon is, or excuse me, American whiskey is. And American whiskey, again, in our idea, is the best whiskey in the world. Not just Kentucky bourbon at this point. Now, American whiskey, for me, I think, and I drink a lot of scotch. I really like Japanese whiskey, too.
Hold on, stop.
But for me, American whiskey is amazing, right?
Stop that horseshit. Raise your hand if you disagree.
Yeah, that's fine.
Oh,
that's
shit.
Fine. Yeah,
you're the fine. Guy in my driveway at 3 in the morning. He doesn't count.
Yeah.
You're exactly right, without a doubt. Yeah.
But Heaven's Door was that idea of you've made it. Open the door, step in, take a look at what we're making, and really experience some of the highest grade of American whiskey, right? Is you're stepping through Heaven's Door. It's the pinnacle. Kind of the same thing with Ascension. You've reached the top of that genre, for lack of a better word. Yeah. Does that answer your question? It's kind of a lot. There's a lot that kind of goes into it. But
hey, so just real quick, anybody ever hear of Nearest Green? Raise your hand high. Uncle Nearest. So Uncle Nearest is the one we believe that brought the Lincoln County process or using charred maple to America. He was a slave. He was an enslaved man who came from Africa. And in Africa, they would use charred maple to purify water.
Yes.
It took out the impurities. It added vitamins and whatnot. And anyway, it changed flavor. But Uncle Nearest is the one who ultimately, Booth, am I saying it right? He created the Lincoln County process by using charred maple to pour the bourbon through, like Africans did in Africa way, way, way back, to purify water.
Yeah. Yeah.
Hold on. Jeremy, what's that?
Taught it, yeah.
He taught it. He did not create it. Thank you.
Has anyone ever had the pleasure of,
thank you.
Of listening to Fawn Weaver speak about this? It's amazing. If you have a chance to go see Fawn talk about that brand, it's incredible. I feel like I'm a pretty good speaker. I feel like you're a pretty good speaker.
Yeah, not really. No.
Got nothing. It's the storytelling that she can do about that brand and about Nearest is really amazing. So, if you
so,
ever have that
so how many people here went to the Uncle Nearest event? Mayor Greenberg, Craig. Everybody say hi to Craig Greenberg. Come on down and have a bourbon with us, Mayor.
Uh-oh.
My favorite bottle? The one I'm drinking. I've known Craig 25 years. He was like 10 years old when I first met him. I babysat him, I think. Everybody say hi to the mayor of the city of Louisville, Craig Greenberg. Good to have you.
Yeah, thank you very much for that. What a treat, right? You thought I was really the draw here, but no, come on, right? Yeah. So what are you thinking about this so far? Let's get some crowd interaction here. Let's talk about revival a little bit. And the name on this, by the way, really reviving that idea of Tennessee bourbon, not Tennessee whiskey, but really designating kind of the differences, the stark differences between those two spirits.
Interesting.
Yeah, let me hear kind of what your thoughts are on this. What are you getting out of Revival?
I'm getting a lot of maple.
Lemon pound cake.
Yeah. What'd you get, James?
Lemon pound cake. Yeah.
Lemon pound cake.
Yeah. Lots of confectionery.
For
kind of
real.
This? Absolutely.
Yeah. Hold on. Bev, what'd you get?
Bubblegum. Yeah.
You get.
That's honestly, if no one has ever heard that about whiskey, bubblegum shows up a lot. And bubblegum
is
really
it like
for
that,
me, right?
Like
it
coming
does.
Out of a baseball card pack, the pink with the powder on it. I get it.
Bubblegum is
it.
Straight. That 100% is correct. Yeah, 100% correct.
Hey, Adam.
Yeah. Boy, that's a really good question. So I just got to ask, which one do I like better?
Rate them. Raisin.
I'll take the water. I'll take the water. Now, you know what? I tend to lean a little bit more towards Ascension, right? And I think for me is I like those really kind of deep, what I've kind of said with the tobacco notes. That's one of those notes that I go crazy for. An American whiskey is, and even Scotch, like some Scotch has some really great tobacco notes in it. I really like that. Because for me, that shows a really nice play between grain and barrel. I think tobacco is the one that you can point to and say, yeast will give you parts of tobacco, grain will give you parts of tobacco, the barrel will give you parts of tobacco. And it's one of those attributes in American whiskey that kind of gets its structure from all parts of that whiskey process.
Yeah. So we've got a raisin. Does anybody get raisin on it?
That's a good one. That's a good one. Yeah. Raisins and stone fruit kind of live similar. I think raisin is a little bit more barrel and stone fruit's a little bit more grain on this. I will say this, Revival, and tell me if I'm shocking you by this, Revival at this point is almost a year and a half older than Ascension.
So what's the total age on it?
So this one is getting close to like 6.5, 7 years.
6.5, 7.
Yeah.
Hey, Jeff, question?
What time does Bob get here? Hey, listen,
it's a surprise. Bob Dylan, he'll show up in about 30 minutes.
I have been very
Sit
lucky.
Sit still and be patient.
I have been very lucky to meet him. Let me put it this way. Bob didn't even show up for his own, like, Nobel Award, right? He didn't even show up for his own, like music, into the Rock and Roll History Museum of Music, right? He didn't even show up for that.
Hold
like,
on,
getting
Adam,
Bob out is tough.
He's not fucking coming. He ain't coming.
To be fair, I didn't know the mayor was going to come, so I've been wrong a
God,
lot.
God, I feel
know.
Like him at the Democratic National Convention. So fucking tell the truth. No, I'm just joking.
No, I mean,
come on. Come on, big dog. I'm messing with you. Bob Dylan ain't coming.
So I'm gonna give you all a little kind of peek, and then we're, whenever you're ready on that next one, we're good.
So hold on.
One out. Yep.
Real quick, Ascension Revival. Who likes Ascension better?
Well, wait, hang on a second. Hang on.
Oh, so ho, ho.
Okay. No, it's okay.
Ho,
it's okay.
Ho.
It's okay. That's okay. So we are going to do something in Q3 for us into the fall where we are actually going to have this program in Kentucky and Tennessee. And it's going to be called Kentucky versus Tennessee, which I thought.
Sponsored by Big Bourbon Club.
Honestly. I thought that was pretty courageous to do in the middle of an election year, but we are going to have sample stations in retailers throughout that third quarter, and they're going to be pouring samples of the Kentucky and of the Tennessee, and they're going to have a little QR code there where you can vote on which one you like more. Now, here's the real rub, though. It's going to be blind. Now, listen. Listen, I tell
you. Stop it. Stop the madness.
The reason we're going to do that is because I have done a lot of single barrels for this brand already, right? And the single barrels, most of the time they've been Tennessee until we introduced Ascension. And here in Kentucky when I was doing single barrels, and I've only done a couple of the Kentucky ones so far. We were always using Kentucky. But at every single one of those Kentucky single barrels, I throw in a Tennessee. I do. And I'm not going to shout out the retailer because that's kind of an asshole move. I'm not going to do that. But I had a retailer who blind picked the Tennessee barrel that I put in there. And when I flipped it over and showed them, they said, never mind, we'll take the Kentucky. So just saying, with us here in Kentucky, and Tennessee does it on the other side, sometimes mentally that'll kind of push you over to that side a little bit. So I always find that very interesting.
Hold on. Serious shit. Does anybody know why Jesus wasn't born in Tennessee? They couldn't find a virgin or three wise men.
Oh, God.
Hey, it's my event. It's a joke. It's a joke. It's a joke. The Chinese TikTok doesn't own me. I can do anything I want. I don't care. I do not care. All right. I'm sorry, Adam. You were talking.
No, you're fine. You're fine. I don't know. I just really like that idea of kind of pushing yourself a little bit, right? So I've been lucky enough to be part of this industry for almost a quarter century now, and the supplier side for almost a decade. And I think there's really a big thing about the mental part kind of getting in your head a little bit and sort of pushing you one way or another. There was this really great study out, and this is about wine. So if I got any winos in here, like, I love wine. You'll appreciate this. There was this really great study that came out in mid-90s, and they essentially put bottles of wine in front of people with samples, and the labels were very nondescript labels, but they were heavy on imagery. So one label would have lots of red, or one label would have a very dark label and, like, you know, a tree and, like, wildlife on it, something like that, right? And then they would ask for notes back from people, and what they found was that people would hit on aspects of those labels. So, for instance, that dark label, they kept getting signifiers like earthy and dark, things like that, right? Or a bright label, they would be like, oh, there's tons of citrus in this. So labels have a very solid impact on how you perceive that liquid. And I've always found that very fascinating.
I agree.
I find that very fascinating.
Hey, let me interrupt. Tim Parsons, stand up. Tim Parsons, stand up. So Tim's a friend. He was actually a vendor to this development, made signs and whatnot. And Tim's a member of the Big Bourbon Club. Thank you to Lewis, who introduced us. And Tim texts me out of the blue, stay standing, big guy. Tim texts me, I don't know, 5 weeks ago, four, whatever it was. He goes, hey, man, I just went down to this place called The Last Refuge. He goes, you've got to see it. I'm like, I think I heard about it. And he said, let me introduce you to Tula out of Chicago, who runs the whole thing. And so Tim introduced me to Tula. I didn't know this place existed. And the reason we're here is because of Tim Parsons. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Tim. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. Tim, stand up. Okay. No, I'm just joking. Sit down. Sit your ass down. No, in all seriousness. So raise your hand if you know Steve Tarver. Raise your hand high. So Steve was the CEO of the YMCA of Louisville for 48 years, probably. Gary Cobbs, come here, man. Come here. So I meet this dude. I'm walking out of the PGA tournament last week, and this guy keeps bumping into me like he had too much bourbon, which is not true. Gary just replaced Steve Tarver, who retired. He's the head of the YMCA Louisville, Kentucky.
Yeah.
We're good to have you, brother. And he told me, I said, Gary, I don't give a shit about the YMCA. Do you like bourbon? He goes, I do like bourbon.
I love bourbon.
And I said, I'm going to invite you to my first event. So, Gary, welcome to Louisville, Kentucky.
Thank you, brother. Appreciate
where are you,
it.
Where are you from?
So, originally, I'm from Tennessee.
Tennessee.
Oh, boy. You know what they call a good-looking girl in Tennessee? A tourist. I'm just joking.
Man, thanks, man.
Good to have you, brother.
Thank you, sir.
All right.
Wait, no, we gotta ask you. We gotta ask you. I gotta know. I got a Tennessee guy here, right? Which one of those do you like better?
Ascension.
He liked the Ascension. See?
The Kentucky Bourbon. Hey, Gary, welcome to Louisville, Kentucky. We're glad to have you. You make Louisville better. You just raised the average IQ about 13 points.
Oh, goodness. You're a terrible man. Boy, you're terrible.
It's my club. I can do anything I want.
You can do whatever you want.
I don't give a shit.
All right. So we've got that third sample coming out to you. Should be done in just a couple more minutes. I'm going to kind of prime this.
So hold on. Let me do this. Quit priming. Questions of Adam. Questions on the vision, the spirits, the distillery. Questions.
I usually give way too much information right up top, and so everyone's like, I don't really have any questions left. Ah, yes, absolutely.
Are you going to do anything like special barrels that you make in, wine casks?
No.
Hopefully
not. No, 100% we are. Absolutely. And in fact, the last sample that we're going to have tonight are one of those. Yeah, yeah. So we like finishes. We like finishes. And me in this industry, I think a lot of times I've kind of heard from the consumer side that, oh, you're trying to hide something. And you know what? There's been plenty of those on the market that they had subpar whiskey and they wanted to hide it with some Zinfandel barrels or something like that. But I am a huge fan of that because I think that's when you start to get into the culinary aspects of whiskey. So, yes.
All right, yes, Lewis.
Sir. Yeah.
Hey, Lewis, stand up. Act like you've spoken in public before.
I think I'm going to like this question. Yeah. How's that?
Start with a billion.
Smell Cheerios,
donut seeds.
Holy sheep, yeah.
Honestly, when the owner of a bank asked me,
everybody
you know how you can
boo
make a fortune,
on three. One, two,
right.
Three. Oh my God, I hope you never sponsor an event again. Mark Highball.
Yes. Yeah, so the first two are both 92 proof. The third one that we're sending out right now is 100 proof. The third one we're sending out right now is actually a blend between three whiskeys. And the reason it's at 100 proof is, A, it tasted good at 100 proof. But, B, it's great to have that baseline for all three whiskeys. It's easier to blend when you're at that 100 proof, right? We do absolutely do barrel proof stuff. If you ever get a single barrel from Heaven's Door, that is always cask strength. It's always barrel proof. The bootlegs are always barrel proof. We have, what else is going? There is a really nice one called Homesick Blues that is a Minnesota weeded bourbon. The reason we did it is because Bob is from Minnesota, and that one is barrel proof. So a lot of times our LTOs.
Say that
are
again.
Barrel-proof.
Bob Dylan's from Minnesota.
He is, yeah, and he lives in Minnesota. Absolutely. Yeah.
He lives there still?
Yeah, he still lives in Minnesota.
What part of Minnesota?
Prince. He won't tell anybody. Prince and Bob Dylan, both from Minnesota. Crazy, right?
Wow.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Wow.
Yeah. Yeah, that Homesick Blues, if you ever see it out, don't let the Minnesota designation pull you out. It is great. It is awesome. Yeah. Yeah. It's Minnesota. In Minnesota. Yeah. It's got a lot of corn on it. It's got a lot of corn on it. Oh, did you have a
hold on a second. Hold on. Hal Ginsberg. Stand up, Hal. Well, all right, Hal, we didn't hear you. You had the Homesick Blues. We did.
There you go.
You know what? I don't remember that, but thank you very much.
Well,
Brian Hauser. Hey, stand up, Brian. Brian sent me a picture at 5 a.m. He left Franklin, North Carolina to drive here today.
Hey, all right.
And he's got a sunset. Swear to God. He's got a picture of the sun barely up coming over the Blue Ridge Mountains, and it is gorgeous. And he also came to the Pleasureville event. Do you remember the Homesick Blues? Don't screw up. Just say yes. Hey, thank you for coming all the way in. Who drove in tonight not from Louisville? Who's not from Louisville? Raise your hand.
Hey, all right.
Raise your hand like you care.
Welcome. Oh, he's in Jeffersonville. My God, I can skip a rock and hit your house, dog. And it's a big old house, so it'd be hard to miss.
To be fair, I live in New Albany.
Part of the Gillette family. I think we talked about that.
Go down, baby. That's a rough life when you work mostly in Louisville and those bridges go down.
You know it. You know it's hard to hide money, they say.
Man, those Indiana drivers are real good.
You know how come Kentucky doesn't sink into Tennessee?
Why?
Because Indiana sucks. That was a joke. My wife went to IU. We grew up. Oh, forget it.
No comment.
It's a joke.
No comment.
It's a joke. You can't cancel me.
You really kind of approach this like a stand-up comedian. How many people from out of town do we have here tonight?
No, I've got some long jokes I'm getting ready to go into.
What's the deal with airline food?
Did y'all hear about the new paratrooper and the Catholic priest? No, I'm just joking. Question. What's
proof
the
proof? On the homesick blues? Oh, the third one. The third one? Okay, so does everybody have the third one in front of you? Who's missing some still? Yeah, excellent. All right, so let's move on. So this one is Revelation. This is 100 proof, and it is actually a blend of three whiskeys. And I really love Revelation. I really, really love Revelation. And here's why. It is a blend of bourbon from Kentucky. It is a blend of bourbon from Tennessee. And it is a blend of rye whiskey from Indiana. And I bet you can't tell me where that came from. 95.5.
I think I've got a
right.
joke.
Yeah.
I'm just joking.
Oh, is it about Indiana? Because that one didn't go over well.
Well, it's a really good joke. I'm just afraid to be honest.
Well, you can't leave us hanging. What's the joke?
I just told to never get a good keep going.
So I really like that idea of kind of like a multi-regional whiskey blending together, right? And the reason this is called Revelation is because it was quite a revelation how these played together. Now, there is an added aspect to this, and it is a straight blend, a third, a third, a third. And they blend at barrel proof, and then they blend at 100 proof. So they have that baseline, so they're easily, per volume, right? It's easy to weigh it out that way. This one has an added step, and this is a finished barrel. It is a secondary finishing of just a second barrel. And that second barrel is a toasted Kelvin barrel. All of our barrels, by the way, are Kelvin barrels. Is anybody familiar with Kelvin Cooperage? Yeah? So Kelvin Cooperage, if you are not familiar, Kelvin is in the south of Louisville. They are fantastic at what they do. Not only is every barrel charred, of course, it is toasted first. And how they achieve that is they do not use a gas flame. They actually take those barrels and they set them on top of these grates, and underneath that grate is an oak fire because they got a lot of oak left over, right? And has anyone here ever been to Kelvin? Ever got a chance to walk through? Man, I'll tell you, it's amazing. They take that barrel, it doesn't have either heads on it, they put it on that grate, and it toasts that barrel for about 15 minutes. And the toasting really does a great job of pulling a lot of oils out of that wood and getting them to the inside of that barrel. After they're done toasting, they take this lid and they put it on top of that barrel, and it increases the pressure inside there, and they take it off, and it's like a jet engine. And at that point, you're charring. And we do a level 4 char on all of ours. What you're doing, right, those oils, they get trapped. They get, you know, the sugars get caramelized, of course, and those oils are now in that charcoal layer that's inside of those barrels. So you get a little bit more barrel influence doing it that way. So that was truly where the revelation came for the name on this.
So you're always char 4?
Always char 4. Always char 4. That may change at some point. You might do some other things out there that are char 3. But really, I think a baseline, just having that baseline doing a char 4 is fine. When I was at Rabbit Hole, everything was char 3. And everything was char 3 because it made sense, right?
Right.
So really, for me, I think it needed that. I have had the liquid before it gets put in that secondary barrel. And I will say this, it is really sweet. I mean, too sweet. Really, really sweet. That toasted barrel is much more subtractive than it is additive. It actually pulls a lot of that sugar actually back out. Now, if we had used a secondary barrel that was charred, we would probably be adding more sugar at that point. It would be much sweeter. And I think Revelation really needs that. It needs that. I think Revelation has a really nice kind of mix of spice versus sweet that's pretty balanced. I really like a lot of balance in my whiskey. I don't like things to be super out of pocket when it comes to tasting. I mean, I like funky things sometimes. I like things that get, you know, it's got a lot of this or a lot of that.
Hold on a second. You said funky.
Mm-hmm.
Last night, a friend of mine came over to the house in the driveway, and he brought a 2-liter Diet 7-Up. Would that be funky?
That's something. I don't know if it's funky,
Steve. I'm not going to mention anybody's name, but Lewis, that's funky.
Was it from the 80s or something? Because then it'd get funky. Yeah, there'd be some funk in there at that point. Yes, sir. Older, actually. So the Kentucky bourbon that's in there is actually 7 years old. And I do have to, like, I have to say this. It's undisclosed where it came from. I actually have never really kind of dug, because I don't even want to know, because then I have to tell you.
Take a guess, Adam.
Right.
Just take a big old guess.
Beam! sorry. So the Kentucky is 7. The Tennessee is right at 7 as well. The MGP is a little bit younger. It's sitting about 5.5, 6. Yeah. But generally, this is kind of our oldest one in our core line right now. So what do we think of Revelation? Drastically different than before, right?
Rob,
yeah.
Thumbs up.
Thumbs up on it, yeah.
What do y'all think about Revelation, everybody? All right, just real quick, straw poll. Ascension was number one, right?
Ascension so far has been number one.
So
yeah.
Raise your hand if you like Ascension best. Oh, boy. Probably 15%. Number two?
Was Revival. Revival.
Revival.
Yeah. You like Revival? Yeah.
So less Revival. Number three, Revelation.
You like Revelation, yeah.
Oh, wow. 1 and 3 are kind of, you know, we're going on the home stretch.
You know what?
That's a horse term.
From the brand. Is it? From the brand point of view, I love that. It always makes me a little worried when, you know, I kind of do that and everybody says the same thing about one product. Because I'm like, well, what's the point of having multi-products
at that
point, right?
You're
really kind of spreading the love around a little bit.
Hey, Robin.
Oh, yeah.
Hold on. Oh. Quiet. Question, Robin.
So price point. Revival and Ascension are the same. They're $49 to $54. Revelation's like usually about $5 more. Yeah. So you're looking anywhere between like $55 and $59 for Revelation.
Debbie, question.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Are you a plant? Did you ask that because you knew I wanted to talk about it?
Debbie and I were on the phone last night at 11 o'clock talking about
questions. Running the script, right. Yeah, absolutely. So those gates that I was talking about earlier, these are taken from those gates. Now, personally for me, I like the new labels. We kind of shrunk them down a little bit. I think they're a little bit more trade friendly. And my big thing with that, if you look at these older labels, the name's all the way down at the bottom. When you look at these newer labels, there you go. Side by side. The name is at the top. And as somebody who lives very much in what we call the on-premise world, so bars and restaurants, that's a huge focus for me. Retail's great, but I think that bars and restaurants really, they push brand more than retail's a lot of times, right? Yeah, that's where you get to go try it. And you put these old bottles back on the back bar, they get kind of lost. You can't tell what they are. You put the new ones up there, Heaven's Door's right at the top, you can spot it from a mile away, and you go, yeah, give me that Revelation, right? Yeah. So, and I think that is really a sign of where the brand is now. You know, 3-4 years ago, we were in like 7 states, right? Today, we're in almost every single state, and we are international, too. We're in 5 different countries as well. So I think at a certain point, and, you know, forgive like the kind of misogynistic sort of term here, but you got to put your big boy pants on.
Don't go there,
right?
Put your big boy pants on. Don't go there at my club.
Do some good branding, right? You do. You got to grow up a little bit. And I think these are a little cleaner and have that kind of big brand look, right? Let's talk about some notes of Revelation, right? So I kind of named you a few. I think there's a good balance between spice and sweet. I think the floral aspect kind of takes a back seat on Revelation for me. It's not as delicate as Ascension and Revival. I think a lot of times they think that they're going to add water to something and they're going to tame it down a little bit. Not at all, right? A lot of times you add water to something, it gets spicier. You actually get more of the spice. Less alcohol, obviously, but I think you get a little bit more play kind of there on the sides of the tongue when you add water to stuff. Revelation is no different. You add water to Revelation, the spice actually becomes much more prevalent than the sweet. It really does. It's a really good, it's great neat. I think it makes a really great cocktail. Where are my paper plane friends here? Anybody love a paper plane? It is 100% my favorite cocktail. Revelation is the perfect whiskey for a paper plane. And if anybody knows about a paper plane at all, it is considered the most balanced cocktail. It's made that way. It's supposed to be very balanced. Revelation.
You call it a paper plane?
Uh-huh, paper plane.
I'm not familiar with it. What is it?
So paper plane is, let me see, bourbon, Amaro, Amaro Nonino is what it's actually supposed to be called. What's the third one? What am I missing? Aperol. And then
raise your hand if you've never heard of a paper plane. Mm-hmm. All right, so listen, we may have an idea for you.
Yeah, paper planes are awesome. We make a fantastic paper plane here. I highly recommend getting one. Yeah, it's a very classy looking drink, so you can really schmooze with people with it. paper plane. So a paper plane.
Hey everybody, hold on. We got a question in the back. Hold on, everybody.
Yeah, so it's equal parts bourbon. It's equal parts, right? Yeah. Equal parts bourbon. I think you're supposed to use bourbon in a paper plane. You're supposed to use bourbon, right?
It's really going to be something that's going to be in the 100 proof range.
Exactly.
We make cocktails, from our perspective, we always want it to be a minimum of 100 proof because it gives us a big, beefy backbone that we can hang a lot of flavor on.
Yeah, it plays well. And then you've got equal parts of that bourbon, Aperol, and then the person that created the paper plane, they specifically asked for something called Amaro Nonino. Now, there's a bunch of different Amaros out there, and I think bartenders they like to experiment with different types of Amaros. I think Nonino is really perfect for a paper plane, but I've had it with the Quintessa before, and that's really good. And then lemon juice. You need a little lemon juice on there, too.
Mm-hmm. Anyone's never had a Amaro Nonino before? Essentially, it tastes like graham crackers and
plain
orange
peel. Yeah,
it's
awesome.
Does anybody not like graham crackers? That's not true.
You like it?
All right, so we've got our fourth one being poured right now. Before we move on to that, I want to talk a little bit more about this space. So I think Lee kind of gave you a pretty good sort of, download of this. But if you are not familiar with this space, so the church itself was built in 1860. And it was here for a very, very long time. They added on to the church this section right here in mid-20th century. And if you look down, you can tell you are on a basketball court. And we left that here. And right in the middle of that basketball court is the logo for the basketball team. And it was a mission that was here. And it was called Refuge in Kentucky. It was called Refuge in Kentucky because people needed that here, right? There were a lot of people, at-risk kids especially, were a big part of this mission. And so when the church closed down, I think there was a couple things that were trying to move in here. And when we finally came into the space, the name was just obvious to us. You know, the last refuge because of the refuge in Kentucky. I think there's a lot of really amazing history here. Pretty much everybody that works here, they have a lot of knowledge on the history of this building. So after this event, please feel free to stick around, grab another drink, get a paper plane, and talk to some of the staff about it. They love talking about this space. It is beautiful. We do have a section upstairs that is still technically closed to the public. It's the sanctuary of the old church, and that is going to be our event space, and it is beautiful. It is absolutely gorgeous.
Has anybody been upstairs yet?
Anybody check that? It's
just
gorgeous,
a few.
Right?
Go upstairs before you leave here tonight.
Well, of course.
It'll blow your mind.
All right.
All right. What's up?
So we are getting ready to hand out our last sample. This last sample is something very, very limited. This is going to be called Exploration. Now, if anybody is familiar with some of our limited offerings so far, we had a limited offering called Decade. And Decade started 2 years ago. Mm-hmm. And the first one, it's always 10 years old. It's always 100 proof. That one was our Tennessee bourbon, and it was the last of the Dickel stocks, actually. And that was delicious. And that one, actually, I think was technically 11 years old. The second one came out last year, and that was a rye. And we straight up got a 10-year-old 95.5 from MGP. It was really, really delicious. We've got one more that's coming out later on this year. That will be our last decade, and it will be a 10-year-old Kentucky bourbon. Once decade is done, exploration is going to take the place of that. And what the whole idea of exploration is exploring different finishes with wood. We are looking, and I think technically we can say we already have, we're partnering with the Single Oak Project. If you are unfamiliar with Single Oak Project, they are really big in consumer education about oak. There is a pretty big misconception among consumers that the American whiskey industry is devastating oak forests. And maybe early on, when it kind of the boom happened, there was this sort of, you know, rush to get barrels made, and yeah, a lot happened. But those people are really good. The people, the loggers are really good at, you take an oak down, you plant two. And so there's been a lot of growth. And if anybody is unaware, white American oak is some of the fastest growing oak in the world. And it's perfect for American bourbon because, or American whiskey, because it's the least porous oak in the world, right? So we're looking with the exploration series to really start pushing the consumer education about oak. Everybody here is aware of the bourbon laws, right? So it must be 51% corn, and it's got to be made in America. The one about oak, can anybody here recite the actual law about oak? Does anybody know it? Yeah? Yeah? No? Who wants to take a stab? You got to take a stab? All right, stand up. Who delivered?
James Case.
James, tell me about oak. What does the law say? Yeah. So let's
hey,
pack
hold
that
on,
down.
Hold
a little
on.
Bit.
James, who introduced you to Big Bourbon Club? Who introduced you to? No, say it loud and have him stand up.
He is standing.
He is a big deal. His knees aren't worth a shit, but stand up, Al. Is it okay?
So I always really love that law and the way that it's phrased, because you can hit a certain part of that, right? So must enter no age statement, by the way. That's one of my favorite things that I think people who are newer to bourbon, they don't know that there is no limit on age. You can literally age it for 2 microseconds. You can call it Kentucky bourbon as long
That's
as you
right.
follow everything else.
Right.
Right? I love that.
We have a new
question. Right?
Ed, you have a question over here?
Yeah. There you go. That's another good one. Does not
white
have
American
to be
oak.
White oak. It can be any oak, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. But it had to, in order to hold, because it's not very porous, right? A lot of the other oaks, it'll leak out of there. Man, really good example. Anybody ever messed with Mizanara before? That was like the hot item a couple years ago to finish a Mizanara oak. If you've ever seen one of those barrels, they leak like a sieve. It's crazy how much you lose, right? So white American oak is perfect for that. But that other part of it has to be charred, right? Has to be virgin, has to be one use only, can't reuse it and call it bourbon. But I always love that idea that there's no age statement, right? But my favorite part of that law are containers. It does not say barrels. So you can age in like a brand new charred oak trapezoid. It's very hard to move around the distillery, though. That's why a lot of people use barrels. But the reason that law is written that way was because a lot of people couldn't afford new barrels when they started a brand. So you can put it in an oak container and add, or just a regular container and add oak chunks to it, and that is considered entering an oak container, right? A really good example of that, Broken Barrel. If anybody familiar with Broken Barrel Spirits, right? They do that. They take broken down barrels that, you know, that couldn't hold anymore, and they throw it in that liquid, and they age a lot of their liquid. And I will say, I think it's delicious. I think they do delicious things. So I always thought that was a very, very cool kind of hit on that law and the way that it's worded. Really, really neat to me. Anybody knows I'm a big geek about stuff like that. So labeling and laws, boy, I'll dig into those.
There's a lot to it.
I love it.
A lot to it. How many people in here like scotch? All right, y'all can walk out now, right now. Go. No, I'm just joking.
The peatier, the better. Give me the iodine, baby.
How many people
baby?
Here like, love hold on, it. How many people here like Irish whiskey?
Yeah.
Don't break an arm jumping up that fast.
I do love Irish whiskey. I like peaty. Like a tire fire and a Band-Aid. Oh, I love it. I think the first time you have a peated scotch is like the same. It's like the first time you had a beer. You're like, I can't believe people drink that. And you kind of like find yourself thinking about it, wanting to drink more. That's how it was with peated whiskey. Man, I love it. Oh, I've seen it. I've never had it, though. It's a peated Irish, right? Yeah, no, that's, you're talking my love language right there. I love it.
Your what?
My love language is that peated. Peated your whiskey, man. We can do some peated American whiskey,
that's
too.
That's
kind of right?
Weird, but go ahead, keep going.
I love it, baby. I love it. All right, so who's still waiting on that fourth sample? We got some here. Who else are we waiting on that fourth sample?
You ready for four?
A couple more down there. Okay, just
so let me
away.
Ask a question. Yeah. Hey, hold on. Thank you, Chip. Put it right on me. Put it right. How many people here are not from Kentucky that traveled in? Raise your hand big. All right, we're going to start with Mo. All right, hold on. Yell out where you're from, Mo.
Columbus, Ohio. Michigan.
Hold on. It's not number two, Tommy. She said the Ritz out of Columbus. That's what's number two? Michigan? Stand up, Tom Morrow. Is there any way he's from Wisconsin at all? Could he get into the Michigan State? Tom left early this morning to come here. So glad you're here.
Yeah, thanks, Tom.
And you too, Kim. We're more happy about you than Tom. Who else? Where y'all from?
Atlanta.
Hotlanta. Where y'all like from? Like Alpharetta? Oh, you're on the rich side. I got you, big dog. Atlanta, Georgia. Where else are we from? Florida. What part of Florida? Oh, they're at the Villages. I'm not judging. You do whatever you like. No, they're not from the Villages. We were joking earlier. Where's everybody else from?
Sometimes that does feel like an out-of-state place.
Jeffersontown.
Jeffersontown sometimes.
Who is Jeffersontown named for? Who is Jeffersontown named for? Thomas? No, it's Billy Jefferson. Who cares?
Is it Jefferson Davis? I don't know. Was that maybe the...
You're from Nashville. You didn't even raise your hand.
I think everybody at this point, I think we got the last rate going out. Everybody's got that fourth one. So we got the last rate coming over to you right now. Yeah. All right. So before we dig into this, we're going to do something fun. You've got that box right there in front of you with the Glen in it, right? So that
don't
is yours to
keep. Don't open
it
yet.
That is yours to keep. And the reason I brought those is so that you didn't steal their Glens. I know. I've been doing this for a while. I know, right? But here's the fun part, right? Does anybody have an empty box in front of them? Anybody got an empty one? You got an empty one? There should be another one. You got an empty one over here?
Oh, yeah. There's Lee Haskin. The two of you, come on up here with empty boxes.
Winner, winner, chicken dinner.
Oh,
you get something there.
Come on. Now, Lee, I hope you prepared a two-minute speech.
How about Brian Stoll?
That's not empty.
Well, now, first, this is not the prize. It's the actual Glen. I want to make sure you leave with the Glen Karen.
Oh, thank you.
But that's here is you. Something very cool. You got an empty one, too? Nice try. This is honey that we have aged in the Ascension bourbon barrels for 8 months. And let me put it this way. My wife It's very funny. My wife does not drink bourbon, and she really doesn't drink any. She's just not a drinker, and she's one of those people that she smells something, and she's like, ugh, right? I got my first sample bottle of this in, and it came out. I was very excited, and I opened it, and I smelled it, and it straight up smelled like a bottle of bourbon. And I was like, honey, here, try this. And she, usually when I give her something, she's like, no, I'm fine. You already know I'm going to hate it. And she was like, oh, I love honey, and took a sniff of it and, like, did not talk to me for, like, an hour. So it is very bourbon forward. Enjoy. Enjoy. You're very welcome. Very nice.
All right, and we have one more.
All right.
You bunch of bourbon bastards.
All right. Oh, we're going to save that one.
Oh,
we're
sorry.
We're going to do that one after.
All right. Yeah. Sorry, Mr. Bastard.
Oh, no, it's okay.
Okay.
So, this final product, this is exploration. And remember that we were talking just a minute ago about exploration, what that means in terms of exploring what different types of oak finishes, different types of finishes are going to do, and really looking forward to doing a lot of education for the consumer, right? You can probably see the color of this is quite dark. This is essentially Revival. This is our Tennessee bourbon that we then aged in Calvados apple brandy barrels, right? Now, just like with Revelation, this became very sweet very quickly. And we kind of have three sort of main parts of our business right now. We've got the home office up in Chicago, which is where Mark is. We've got Pleasureville down in Henry County. And then where we bottle and warehouse some of our products down in Memphis, Tennessee. We finished this first. So we had the Tennessee bourbon in Chicago and Tennessee, and they had some really good barrels. And they're like, hey, we want to do some extra stuff with this. So send it down to Pleasureville. And that is where we finished in Calvados apple brandy barrels for about 6 to 8 months, right? And then we're doing QC there, and we send samples out up to Chicago, over to Memphis. Everybody's trying through it. And Memphis comes back with the first response, and they're like, that is really sweet. Send it down here. We're going to do something else to it. They took toasted French oak staves and dropped them into those barrels and let them sit there for another 6 months. So this is actually a triple finish, right? Oh, I guess a double finish. Yeah, it's a double finish. So you got the Tennessee bourbon. Finished in, yeah, very much like the Maker's Mark kind of barrel finishing, right? Yeah. The French oak tank, yeah, absolutely. It really kind of does
hey,
the same
James,
thing as
we
that.
We have
that,
one more sheet up here if you want to come up.
I mean, honestly, yeah.
I'm just joking.
But I think it kind of pulls back a little bit some of that sweetness and balances it again, right? So, cheers.
Wow.
Cheers. This is very good. Yeah. Sláinte, right?
Hey, everybody, oh, wow. As you're sipping this, do me a favor. Everybody listen up. Listen up. Listen up. Everybody, turn around and look up at Nikki Thomas. Nikki is the head, she's the sales manager for the property. She's the one who I first met that welcomed us in and said, we'll open it for the Big Bourbon Club. Nikki, we love you. Now, you didn't say you're going to do that. If you ever want to come here and do a special event, a private event, a big event, a small event, Nicole, she told me today, she goes, Steve, I'm not Nicole. I'm spicy today.
She's spicy
today. I'm going to
be called Nikki. Yeah.
So she goes by Nikki, Nicole. But anyway, Nicole, thank you so much, sweetie. We appreciate you.
So what do you all think of this? Now, this one is our highest proof at this point for today's tasting.
Maybe
this
not.
Is 108 proof. We can't really call this casks. I mean, you kind of can, but the reason we don't really like to lean on the cask strength is because it lost proof in the cask while we were doing some of these finishes, but we did not water this down or anything. We didn't dilute this when we put it in its final bottle and labeled it out. It came out after both of those finishes at about anywhere between 107.5 and like 109.1. So this is right at about 108 proof. Yeah.
So generally speaking, how many people would prefer not to have a finished bourbon? Raise it up. That's all right. Raise it up. All right, not very many. So that means that 90% of you like finished bourbons better than non-finished. Is that right? Raise your hand. Okay. Okay, so 98% did not vote, or they didn't listen, or they don't give a shit.
Well, you know why, Steve? Because they got this in front of them right now.
Well,
they're enjoying this.
Without a doubt, they're distracted.
Yeah. Is anybody familiar with Calvados? Does anybody know what that is? Yeah. So, what's that?
Okay. Question. Hold on. Hey, everybody, it's getting really loud in here. Hold on.
So, Calvados is a brandy. It's brandy is essentially whiskey, but instead of being made with grain, it's made with fruit, right? Calvados is an apple brandy. Apple brandy is strong, but it's very sweet. It's very, very sweet. And so when you take something like a bourbon that is already very sweet and you finish it in something that is also sweet, it's like sweet on sweet on sweet, right? So I think that's really where those French oak staves came in very handy to drop in there to make sure we were pulling that back a little bit. And I think that's an important thing to kind of start pushing into the consumer mindset, into your mindset even, right? Is that oak is king, sure. Oak, everybody thinks they want like the oldest, oakiest bourbon until you've had the oldest, oakiest bourbon. And like you, like your water won't, like water won't even cut through that, right? It's just so dry and it's so overpowering. There is that really masterful art of creating balance in whiskey, whether it's through blending, right, whether it's through barreling, whether it's through finishing. And I think that's where the real beauty of finishing is that you are looking for something that is balanced, that is palatable, that is also good. And that's a very tough dance to do, right? That's really, really hard. And I'm going to be very honest with you right now. There is something that really irks me about something that happens in bourbon consumer lands, right? And I am a whiskey nerd. I am a whiskey nerd. But whiskey nerds can be very, very guilty of this. With a bottle they don't like, and they call it a drain pour. And I'm going to tell you this.
Do you know what a drain pour is? You pour in the drain, it's so bad.
You don't like it, so you're going to pour it into a drain.
You pour it down the drain.
I have a lot of friends that work in this industry. And not all my friends are big, important ambassadors. Some of them are. But my real friends are people in production. And if you have never spent time with a distiller or spent time with someone in a warehouse or spent time with a blender or people in the QC, that is hard, hard work. That is hard work. For those of you that have been to distilleries before and show you a lot of that work, you could probably agree with that statement. And so when I see somebody taking a bottle and they're pouring it down a drain, man, it hurts. It hurts. You don't like the bottle? That's great. Make chili out of it. Give it to a friend.
Give it to one of my four kids.
Do something with it.
They'll drink anything.
Don't throw away your bourbon. Don't throw away your bourbon unless it's like it's got jasmine in it or something. You can throw that one away. If it's got like something that really is not good for you, throw that one away. But very few times do things make it through QC that are going to be bad for you. You don't like it, give it away. Share it out. Use it as a point of reference for yourself. It is very easy to say what you don't like. It is very, very hard to say what it is you like. And I don't mean that just with whiskey. I mean that with food, with cocktails, with lemonade, whatever. It's hard to really nail something. Why do you like something? Take that bottle of something that doesn't jive with your palate and use it as your benchmark and taste things against it that you really do like, you know? I'll be very honest. I have never really been a fan of 95.5 rye, and that's just me. That's just me. I don't like that much kind of herby lit in there. And it took me a long time to figure out why I don't like that. And what I did was I was tasting other ryes against it. And I found out I like things that have like a high corn content in my ryes. So something that's like a 60-40 or something like that. So that really taught me what it was that I really liked about my palate. So that's this. Just a little
All right,
advice.
So,
completely unsolicited.
So number four, what'd you like? What do you think?
Yeah, what do you think of this?
Yell it out. Alice, you like that?
Yeah, she likes it.
Did you like it? What about your Uber driver? You liked it best?
You liked it the best? This is your number one?
Really?
Yeah. Yeah, I'll tell you, it's good.
Jeff, what are you? Jeff, what? You like
big
that?
Big body. Big body, right? Really coats the palate on this one.
Well, it's ironic you like a big body. I'm just joking. He's a good friend of mine. He's losing weight. It's okay. I'm just joking. I love this guy. He's a little bit overweight, but he's been working on it. Lisa, I think it's spicy too. It's not too spicy. What do y'all think?
All right. I just got asked what my favorite was. What
did you think, Tracy's daughter?
I like the exploration a lot.
Is that your favorite?
It's heavy flavor. The word that I use for that is depth. Yeah.
Really?
This has a ton of depth.
All right, let's do a quick straw poll. Ascension, number one. Was that your favorite? Raise it high. Oh, Lord. 35%? 36%? It was a 10-second delay. So that was raise your hand if Ascension was your favorite, the first one. Wow. Consumer research. All right, let's call it 35%. Revival, number two. All right, I'm going to say it's 8, 9, 10%. So we have 55% left. Tracy, math, 55 plus, just joking. She's, oh, hell, she's a CFO of the biggest bank in Kentucky. She gets math. Okay. Hold on. Revelation. Stop, you girlfriend. All right, Revelation. I would say 1% less than Ascension.
I love that. Yeah.
Exploration, the last one. I think the math equaled 100%, Tracy. Yeah. Will you rubber stamp that for us? Audit, that's a full audit.
Yeah, what's yours?
Mark, what's my favorite? I can't hear you, big dog. Whatever you think, son. My favorite's what's in my hand at the moment. I love them all. You know, to be totally honest, my favorite are the higher proof, more complex.
Yeah.
They bite a little bit more. They dance in your mouth a little bit more. And I would say number four is my favorite. I get more spice forward. It's not too much spice, Lisa.
Very balanced.
I think it's
about
fantastic.
It. Very balanced.
Bev, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Hold on. On the nose of the flavor. Hold on, my wife's calling me. Suzanne, I'm on a beverage club. We got 200 people here. I'm just joking. She texted me. Okay, so Bev got marshmallow over a campfire. Can you get a burnt? I got a lot of head shaking. Yes.
Can anybody tell me what that's from? Does anybody know where that? There you go. Toasted French oak staves. Woo-hoo. Going to give you a lot of marshmallow.
You wouldn't have got that at Michter's. Yeah. You wouldn't have got that at Michter's. I hope they gave you a refund.
Now, as you're enjoying this, I've got one more really fun thing for you.
One more really fun thing. I got three more. Keep going.
So go ahead and move your glasses off that tasting mat and flip it over. Does somebody have
you bunch of bastards you
on the back of that bastards. Tasting mat?
There's one person with a note that says, you lucky bastard.
Who's got that?
Somebody's got it. Somebody hadn't turned it over yet.
Oh, they're going to
take it. I think we have one. Who's the lucky bastard?
Hey, there you go. Come on up here.
Jeff just wrote it out. Bill Reynolds, my partner, my friend from Element 502. What does the lucky bastard get?
Hold on, I gotta hit the
button. He's working tonight.
He's literally working right now.
Tim Parsons, you wrote, you can't do that. You went to Ballard, you cheated.
So we're gonna move outside of Bourbon just for a second. And SIP, Spirits Investment Partners, that owns Heaven's Door, also owns something called Rare Hair and Play Hard Spirits. And
have you heard of Rare Hair? Anybody?
No.
Raise your hand. It's a big deal.
Sir, I am about to give you a 30-year-old cognac called Lucky Bastard. Enjoy. You keep up. Now, it's a very small sample, so if you want some, you got to get to them quick because it's going to go very quick, right?
Hey, Bill, that's not a cologne.
It's really just
that.
Perfume, yeah.
No. All right. All right, we're closing up. We're about 30 minutes over. Adam, I'm sorry, big guy. Adam said to me, I've never presented before. Are you okay if I try it for the first time? How'd he do? How'd this guy do?
You're very nice. You're very nice. Thank you.
Hey, has anybody heard of Old Carter? Raise your hand. Raise your hand if you like Old Carter. Booth, stand up, big dog. This is the guy that runs the company here. Booth, and everybody say, hold on. And I got, look around, you know everybody here. And by the way, his pink socks match his coat. Margo, thank God for you getting married, sweetheart. You now taught him how to dress. Margo, we're glad to have you here, sweetie. All right, so any other thoughts, any other questions of Heaven's Door, of Adam, of Lee, of Chef Matt. Chef Matt.
Give it up for the chef, by the way.
Chef Matt.
Yeah. Give it up for the chef. And hey. I would just like to say that I am very grateful for the staff here today, including Chef Matt, including Spicy Nikki, including Lee and Amy, the operations manager.
That's Nicole,
and the staff
not Spicy
here.
Spicy Nikki.
The staff here has been great. So please, please, not only give the staff a round of applause, but tip heavy. Tip heavy. They came in very early on the day off today. So tip heavy today,
please.
Let me
translate that. Give a big-ass tip.
Yeah.
Big-ass tip. They did a great job. And listen, as a reminder, we are the first group that they allowed. They could have said, no, we're not ready. I was told three times we're really not ready, but we want to do it for Big Bourbon Club. So thank you for coming out. Number two, I've been having a tailgate in the parking lot with all of my barrel picks. If you want a barrel pick bottle, come on out. I got a little Venmo code for you, and it's really good. All right, everybody hang out, get a drink. Thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you.
How we do?
I'm knocking on heaven's door.